God in human flesh, the person we call Jesus Christ, is the topic for this summer. Appropriately so in a church, I would suppose. But specifically the problem of Jesus and whether or not this person that we talk about, this person we read about in the scriptures, was who he claimed to be. And what problems, what truths, what difficulties do we encounter because of that belief? That's what we're going to be focusing on. Like as Carrie mentioned earlier, we've been journeying through a book called The Problem of Jesus. You can find it, obviously, through Amazon, Audible. It's also available on, if you have Spotify Premium, you can listen to it on there as well. Our sermons through the summer will be based loosely around those chapters if you want to follow along. And I encourage you to do so because what we're really hoping to help our people to do, help me to do, help you to do, is to wrestle with who Jesus Christ really was. We're talking about the Gospels and what they have to say, and can they be trusted? We're talking about his death and his resurrection. Is there a reason to believe in the accounts of these things? We talk about his life and his claims. Is there a reason to trust that he is who he says he is? Next week, we're actually taking an early pause in the series when Wesley Huff comes to speak for us. Wesley's from Apologetics Canada, and we'll be speaking specifically on the problem of evil. So if you've ever wrestled with the idea, if you wonder why does a loving God allow bad things to happen? Wesley Huff's going to be here to talk to us specifically about that issue from a biblical and from a philosophical standpoint to help us wrestle through that toughest of questions. When every one of us has hit those valleys in life, I'm sure you've hit a moment where you've wondered, God, are you there? God, do you even care? Why would this happen? That's what we're wrestling through next week. But today, we're going to begin to talk about the problem of the historic Jesus. Specifically, how do we know that this person called Jesus of Nazareth, who we believe to be the Messiah, how do we know that he actually lived and really existed? How do we know that he's not just a myth or a fabrication or a story? How do we know that he's anything more than that? My hope for you in this series, over these next 8-10 weeks, wherever you might be in your spiritual journey at this point, that you'll be forced to make a decision about Jesus Christ. That when walking through these sermons, walking through these chapters in this book, sitting and listening through these things and wrestling with it, that you'll be forced to make a decision about who Jesus Christ is. As 1 Corinthians 1:23, the Apostle Paul says this, "We preach Christ crucified, a stumbling block to Jews and folly to the Gentiles. To those who don't believe Jesus Christ and that whole idea is foolishness. It's ridiculous." But what we believe, what we preach, what we teach here at Faith, quoting from the Apostles' Creed, it says this, "We believe in Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell, and on the third day he rose from the dead. He ascended to heaven and is seated at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. This is who we believe the person of Jesus Christ to be. What do you think about it? Just about everybody has an opinion about Jesus. Just about everyone has a thought or an idea about him. And remarkably, TV channels seem to have a lot to say about him, usually around Easter when they can bump their ratings by putting on something about Jesus. And most people, when you if you ask a question, say, well, what do you think about Jesus? If they're unconnected to a church, if they haven't really grown up in that environment, they might say things like, well, he's a good teacher. Right? He has some good things to say. He's a good example to follow. He teaches you on things like love and kindness and self-sacrifice. Those are good things, maybe human ideals that we could aspire to. The problem with that kind of a view, that the idea that, like, well, he was a good teacher, someone worth following, someone worth kind of learning from, is that he's really not. Like, a good dude doesn't go around saying things like he says. John 6:54, he says, whoever feeds on my flesh and drinks my blood has eternal life. And I'll raise him up on the last day. Parents, if your kid brought a friend home who said that, would you want your kid hanging out with that guy? Probably not. Luke 14:26, he says this, if anyone comes to me and does not hate his own father and mother and wife and children and brothers and sisters, and yes, even his own life, he can't be my disciple. Normal people don't talk like this. Certainly someone who would say a good teacher doesn't talk like this. Like, if somebody you loved was following somebody who said, look, you got to hate your own life, you'd be like, okay, there's going to be Kool-Aid and a cult and something involved. Like, we got to get them out of this. There'd be concerns. So, like, the whole idea that he's just this good teacher who had some nice things to say is ridiculous. Because if he's not who he claimed to be, his teachings are what C.S. Lewis would say, put him in one of three categories. A liar, a lunatic, or he's actually Lord. Theologian and writer C.S. Lewis said it like this, one of the most famous quotes. A person who claims to be God must belong to one of the three categories. First, if he claims to be God and yet in fact is not, he has to be a madman or a lunatic. Second, if he is neither God or a lunatic, he has to be a liar, deceiving others by his lie. But third, if he's neither of these, then he must be God. Liar, lunatic, or Lord. So what do we believe about him? There are some critical things we have to wrestle through. Two key questions I want us to dive into and explore today. Number one, did Jesus in fact exist? And number two, if he did exist, why does it even matter? Why is it of any importance to us? Did he exist? And if he did, why does that matter? If he's not who he claimed to be, he's meaningless. Should be forgotten in history. No point even learning about him. But if he is, if he is who he claimed to be, if he really existed, he is the most important figure in history. And what he claims is critical for all of us. It's a matter of life and death for all of humanity. So wherever you find yourself on your spiritual journey, if you might just be a part of the crowd today, you're here, somebody invited you, or you've been around faith, but you would say, I don't really have any belief in this direction yet. I'm hoping there's enough here to make you start to be curious. Make you start to ask questions, make you maybe reevaluate what you believe. If you're already in that place where you're curious and you're investing, you're like, man, I think there might be something here and I've been wrestling with my faith. I hope that as we go through this series, it'll help you to be convinced, to help you to know with certainty that Jesus Christ is Lord. If you're already convinced, you'd say, I'm already a Christian, but maybe you just haven't been growing, maybe you haven't been stuck. I hope this gives you that push in the direction, a reaffirmation of your faith, a burst in confidence. See, begin telling others. Sharing your faith with boldness. Wherever you're at in your spiritual journey, I hope that we're able to help you move a step forward as we talk about this stuff. So we're going to wrestle first with this first question. Did Jesus actually exist? Now, there are two false claims I want to wrestle through primarily. There's a whole lot we could talk about. There's two I want to focus on today. Number one, the false claim is that there's no historical evidence. People say, well, it's just all made up. I remember when I first became a Christian, I was 14 years old, and like I was very timid about my faith. Didn't really like tell friends. I wasn't the guy who, like got saved and then came back with all of a sudden like a passionate evangelist. I was like low key, let's just kind of keep it under wraps, right? But the first time I kind of began to like talk about it a little bit was with my friend Bill, and I just mentioned like, yeah, well, I'm a Christian now, and he just quit back, and he was a quick-witted guy. So he's like, you know, like that whole book was just written by a bunch of guys around a bar years ago. They just made him up. They just made Jesus up. Now that's patently false. But as a new believer, 14 years old, I had no idea how to refute that claim. In fact, it put me on shaky ground for a few days. I'm like, do I have any reason to believe this? Like, I'd accepted it, it shook my faith just enough. And I'm like, well, I don't know. I don't know how to answer this question. I don't know how to push back. And I just kind of walked away stumbling. And like, he existed. No, you're wrong. He's like, well, prove it. I'm like, I can't. Here's a little tidbit first, aside from all this stuff. Important to know as you wrestle through faith, and especially as you begin to share your faith and talk to other people, there will be times where you will encounter questions you have no idea how to answer. It's part of the deal, right? So remember this. Just because you don't have an answer doesn't mean an answer doesn't exist. Okay? Second thing, one of the most loving things you can say to someone who's questioning you is, I don't know, but I'll find out. Right? Because the amount of care that then happens, if you actually come back to that person a week or a day or a month later and say, hey, remember that conversation we had, that question you raised I couldn't answer? I went and found an answer. Would you mind if I shared that with you? That communicates a whole lot of care to that. They're like, oh, this matters to them. Doesn't mean they're going to agree with you, but it communicates a certain amount of care and concern on your part towards that person. So I'd encourage you in that direction. When you encounter questions, don't try to make up an answer. That's the worst possible thing you can do. It's something I am tempted to do all the time. I don't want to look dumb. I want to know like I got the answer. But say, you know what? I don't know. And go back and do the research, or come to one of us pastors. We can help you find an answer. When I don't know, I usually go and ask Pastor Bill, right? That's not a joke. That's like legitimately, Bill, like my first like 2 months as lead pastor, I think I called you like 3 times. Like, hey, somebody said this. What does that mean? Like, we all need people around us who can help us find the information we don't know. So go get the answers. So this is the first myth that like, they say, oh, there's no historical evidence. The second one that gets tossed around is this idea that like Jesus is just a ripoff of other pagan gods. Right? There's a whole whack of books and movies that came out, especially around like 20 years ago or so, that talked about the Jesus myth. A movie called Zeitgeist, another one called Religulous, a book called The Jesus Myth, and others like it, that basically say Jesus is just a kind of conglomeration of various like Greek and Roman and Egyptian gods, and they just kind of took parts of their stories and put them all together and made Jesus. So Christians, he didn't actually exist, it's just a myth, and they kind of made him out of all of these stories, maybe even countered some of these things. Again, patently false, but they spin the stories just well enough to make it seem plausible, and they basically bet on the idea that no one's going to check up on their facts. There's a whole lot we could say about this. And this here you see the Egyptian god Horus. Mithras is the Greek god. Dionysius is a Roman god. And these are three that they point to all the time. They'll say, oh, well, you know, like they all had 12 disciples. And no, they didn't. They'll say, oh, their stories each say that they were born of a virgin. No, their stories don't say that. Oh, it says that Mithras was born in a manger. No, it doesn't. Like, they'll make all these claims without any basis in fact. Not just that we don't believe that they were true of them, but that like even the stories written about them don't say they're true about them. Now, one they come back to, there's dozens of things we could poke holes in. And if you read the book along, the author, Mark Clark, goes a little bit more into detail on this. But here's one we can talk about. So, like, each of these gods has as part of their story being born on December 25th. Right, so the authors of books like Jesus Myth and these movies, Zeitgeist and things like that, point to that as an example, saying, look, Jesus is just a carbon copy of them. He was born on December 25th, just like all these other gods. So he's just another myth. What's the fundamental problem with that? Nobody believes that Jesus was born on December 25th. All right, now you're thinking, well, what about Christmas? Let me explain. All right, so early Christians did not believe Jesus was born on December 25th. No scholar in history or scripture believes that Jesus was born on December 25th. In fact, we don't exactly know when he was born, but it was September, October-ish in there, based on the other kind of events around his date. So why is Christmas on December 25th? It started in the 300s AD. Pope Julius I created the celebration of Christmas and put it on December 25th to go up against the Roman festival of Saturnalia, another god who was celebrated as being born on December 25th. What was the Pope trying to do? He's trying to take a pagan holiday, make it a Christian one. He picked December 25th only because there was already a major religious celebration there. He said, you know what? We're going to celebrate this instead. I think it worked out pretty well. Like, I haven't seen anybody put Saturnalia lights up in a while, right? So, but that was the whole intent. He lined it up on that date specifically so that the Christians wouldn't celebrate these pagan festivals and they would try to draw the people in. That's where our celebration of Christmas kind of has its origins. So again, nobody believes that Jesus was born on December 25th, but those authors will just make that claim, assuming that no one's going to check their background. And again, their claims have been ripped apart by scholars in those fields. But they're just assuming that you're not going to read into it and that they can just throw enough doubt out there to get you wondering. Scholars, again, have called their misinterpretation of documents outright lies. Like, they aren't even in terms of how they treat the text about these gods, they aren't faithful to those texts. They're not telling the full story there. So again, when you encounter claims like this, just know that even if you don't know the answer, if it shakes your faith a little bit, that's okay. Go and investigate it. Because there's truth to be found. So he's not like one of those gods. So let's talk about some of the evidence. So like, we're arguing that he's real, so let's talk about some of the evidence that Christ actually existed. We'll talk about some evidence outside of Scripture and some evidence from within Scripture itself. Okay, let's dive into history a little bit, which I know I love, and some of you guys don't. But you're going to like it, I promise. Maybe not, I don't know. Doesn't really matter, but here we go. Evidence outside of Scripture. First and foremost, Jesus is a verifiably historical figure. There are over 10 authors from outside of Scripture, from that era of history, that write about Jesus. Whether they just kind of refer to him on the side, or whether they write specifically about things that he said and did, he is talked about in first century history. The historians that existed around that time, they write about him, or they refer to him because he was a factor in their stories. Here's a few quotes that have authors either talking directly about Jesus or just kind of referring to him in passing. This first one comes from a Syrian philosopher named Mara Bar Serapion, who lived around the 70 AD. And in this writing, he's writing to his son, trying to encourage his son to pursue wisdom, right, to live a life worthy of wisdom. And writing to his son, he says this. He's using examples from different characters in history. It says, what did it avail the Jews to kill their wise king? He's referring to Jesus. Since their kingdom was taken away from that time on. Socrates is not dead, thanks to Plato, because he lives on through Plato. Nor Pythagoras, because of Herod's statue. Nor is the wise king, because of the new law which he has given. So he just refers to Jesus in line with these other historical figures from around that time, encouraging him, his son, to live likewise. And that the reference he makes there, like in the first line, since their kingdom was taken away from that time on, refers to what Jesus had predicted about the destruction of the temple, which happened around 70 AD in Jerusalem. Tacitus, famous Roman historian, the historian from that era who most of what we know about the Roman Empire from the first centuries AD comes from Tacitus in his book Annals. He writes in extreme detail, one of the most reliable historians in that era. And he has a few places where he mentions either Christians or Jesus kind of in passing. Here's what he says. He's talking about Emperor Nero and the fire in Rome. He says, therefore, to squelch the rumor, Nero created scapegoats and subjected them to the most refined tortures, those whom the common people called Christians, hated for their abominable crimes. Their name comes from Christ, who, during the reign of Tiberius, had been executed by the procurator Pontius Pilate. Again, he's just stating it as a fact. He's giving the context. He's like, yeah, he's like, Nero, because of the fire, blamed it on Christians, used them as the scapegoats, and well, they were called Christians because of Christ, who was crucified under Tiberius. And just referencing the historical fact that Jesus of Nazareth, who they called Christ, had been killed by crucifixion. Third one, Josephus, famous Jewish historian. Again, we have a lot of information about Josephus, a lot of information from Josephus about the first century AD. He writes a lot about Jewish history. That was his primary topic, but in talking about that, he ends up corroborating a lot of what happens in the New Testament. There are several places, stories that happen in the Gospels or in the book of Acts that are also mentioned in passing by Josephus, just by way of history. Here's one thing he says. I'm going to butcher this name, though. He says, Ananus was of this disposition. He thought he had now a proper opportunity to exercise his authority. So he assembled the Sanhedrin of judges and brought before them the brother of Jesus, who was called Christ, whose name was James. What he's talking about there in the longer paragraph is that this new high priest in Jerusalem was trying to seize kind of more authority, kind of make himself more powerful. So while some of the other leaders were away, he took an opportunity to try and have Jesus' brother James killed. Brought him in, put him on trial, and all that. And again, he just references Christ in passing. He's not talking directly about him, but just mentioning him as another historical detail along the way. There's all kinds of evidence outside of Scripture. And here's the thing. No serious historian denies the existence of Jesus of Nazareth. Jesus of Nazareth. No one. The historians that do have the same level of credibility as flat earthers do with astronauts. Okay? Like, they don't take them seriously because there's a mountain overwhelming evidence that Jesus of Nazareth lived, died, was crucified. Now, whether we believe that he was God, those are all questions left unsaid. But for historians, like, yeah, like, this man clearly lived and died when and where they said he did. We don't doubt that. Whether they acknowledge his claims, well, that's a whole other thing. James Charlesworth, from Princeton Theological Seminary, professor of New Testament language and literature, he says this: "It would be foolish to continue to foster the illusion that the Gospels are merely fictional stories like the legends of Hercules. The theologies of the New Testament are grounded on interpretations of real historical events, especially the crucifixion of Jesus at a particular time and place." We know that Jesus of Nazareth existed. Now let's look at some of the evidence from within the Scriptures themselves. Look at Mark chapter 15, verse 21. It says this: "And they compelled the passerby, Simon of Cyrene, who was coming in from the country, the father of Alexander and Rufus, to carry his cross." A little like an innocuous verse in Mark, almost like a tossaway. He's giving some context. You remember this part of the story, that when Jesus was being led towards his crucifixion, and he's carrying his cross through the city, and he gets to a point where he's too weak from the beatings, he can't carry it anymore. So the soldiers compel this guy named Simon out of the crowd and force him to carry the cross. Why does Mark mention this? Well, here's the thing. We look at the Gospels, and the Gospels are our most detailed records about Jesus Christ. If someone were writing myth, writing legend, writing a made-up story, what's the first rule of writing a myth or a made-up story? Don't put real people in it that can call your story a myth. Right? Don't start naming names and places that people can go, well, it didn't really happen there, or I talked to them and they said you're lying. What the Gospels do over and over and over and over again is name people and name places. Specifically, they name people over and over again who are still alive at the time of their writing. Why? What's the point? In fact, there's over 30 people in the Gospels that are verifiable, not just within biblical history, but like outside of biblical history. Why name them? Mark's saying is like, hey, remember like Simon of Cyrene? He was the one forced to carry the cross. And if you don't believe my story, go ask his sons, Alexander and Rufus. You know them. Go find them. Over and over and over again, the gospel writers do those things because people can go and verify the claims themselves. So we have these remarkable details. And what's insane about the gospel is the amount of detail they say about, not just about people who encountered Christ or people who were part of the story, but cities and places and rulers, many who were often like were in doubt historically outside of Scripture for many years until they were confirmed by later archaeological finds. The accuracy is phenomenal. The second question we have to wrestle with then, we have the details in the Gospels that give us lots of evidence, but then we also have the lives of the actual first followers of Christ. And for me, this is what I will always come back to as the primary evidence in Scripture and for the primary evidence of Jesus Christ. Why would they devote themselves to a lie? These first followers of Jesus Christ, why make it up if it's not going to bring them any power or wealth? Because it didn't. It cost almost all of them everything. It cost all of them their lives. So I can see maybe they were following Jesus. He dies and like, look, we can't make this look like it came to nothing. So maybe they make up the story. But in the second it's going to cost you your lives, you think one of them would have spoken up and said, hey, you know what? Just kidding. My bad. Don't want to go on the cross. Please don't stone me. No, every one of them gave their lives. Why die unless they were absolutely convinced? Why give your entire life? Why devote your entire life in every follower of Christ, not just the 12 disciples, but all those early followers? Why would they all devote their entire lives to this cause unless they were 100% convinced of it? Charles Colson, well-known author and writer, speaker in Christianity through the 70s, 80s, and 90s, passed away in around 2012. He wrote a ton of books before he became a Christian. Like, he got saved in 1973. Before he became a Christian, he was a special counsel to President Richard Nixon. You see Nixon on the left there, and that's Colson on the right. Colson also had the dubious distinction of being the first person arrested in relation to the Watergate scandal. So if you have a certain vintage, remember all that going. The Watergate scandal is probably quaint by today's standards. But he was arrested for that, spent some time in prison. Anyway, he wrote a fair bit about this stuff. He had this quote to say about the apostles, about the truth of the claims of Christ in relation to the Watergate scandal. Here's what he says. He says this: I know the resurrection is a fact, and Watergate proved it to me. How? Because 12 men testified that they had seen Jesus raised from the dead, that they proclaimed that truth for 40 years, never once denying it. Every one of them beaten, tortured, stoned, and put in prison. They would not have endured that if it weren't true. Watergate embroiled 12 of the most powerful men in the world, and they couldn't keep alive for 3 weeks. You're telling me 12 apostles could keep alive for 40 years? Impossible. It's an interesting comparison. Right? How could they keep this story for 40 years through death and suffering? It's highly unlikely. So again, why does it matter that Jesus really existed? Why does it matter that he really lives? This is a debate that is of critical importance to all humanity. If Jesus is who he says he is, then his existence is more important than anyone who ever lived, and matters for every single one of us. Every one of our lives is impacted by him. Let's look at this passage in Mark chapter 14. Verses 22 through 25, well-known passage. It's at the Last Supper. It says this: And as they were eating, he took bread, and after blessing it, broke it and gave it to them and said, Take this, this is my body. He took a cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them. They all drank it. And he said to them, This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many. Truly I say to you, I will not drink of the fruit of the vine until the day when I drink it anew in the kingdom of God. Jesus takes this story to gather the night of his crucifixion, the night before his crucifixion. They're sitting down to celebrate what's called the Passover meal, a festival that the Jews had celebrated for well over 1,000 years by that point, a festival that called back their memory to the Exodus, to when they were fleeing out of Egypt, escaping slavery under Pharaoh, being led out by Moses. And they had the bread, the unleavened bread, to symbolize that they had to rush out. They couldn't even wait for the bread to rise. And they had the wine. Remember how God had spared them and spared their lives. Every year they celebrate this. Jesus sits down with them the night before he would be crucified, takes one of their oldest festivals and reinterprets it in light of himself. He's putting new meaning on it. He's preparing them. He's saying, telling them something. He's saying, look, this bread that you've always used to remember your slavery, this is now my body. This wine that has celebrated your escape is my blood. He's putting new meaning on everything, preparing them for something significant. But what's he mean? Why would he do that? Why would the night before he's going to be crucified, why would he take this thousands-year-old tradition and reinterpret it? Because he wants them to understand who he is. When we're reading Jesus, when we're trying to understand who Christ is, and we're trying to think, why does it matter that he existed? One of the fundamental things we have to understand is who he was to the people that he lived with, the time, the place, the people that he spoke to. Jesus Christ was a first century Jewish man, speaking to first century Jewish people primarily. He interacted with Romans and some others as well. But most of what he's saying is in that context. So we have to understand what he's teaching in that place. And when you understand what he's teaching, when you understand what he's saying to those people, he is upending their entire religious system. He's saying everything that they have held so far, not just being tossed away, it's being renewed and completed and made different through him. When Jesus tells the disciples that the body and the bread and the blood, the body said that the bread is now his body, the blood is his wine, he's saying, see, there's a significance of what I'm doing. He's showing the disciples that they're reaching a new stage in salvation history. The old covenant that they lived under, the Old Testament, is now completed and superseded by him. He's bringing something new, something bigger. His entire life was a picture of Israel's story, then brought to a climax by him in his life in Christ. Think about some of the imagery from his life. When he's tempted in the wilderness for 40 days. It's a picture of Israel in the wilderness for 40 years. Where they tried and failed to follow God. Where they failed, Jesus succeeded in being absolutely loyal and perfect with the Father, not sinning once. What Israel couldn't do, Jesus did perfectly. Each temptation, if you read through that story, each time Jesus is tempted, what does he quote back to Satan? Deuteronomy, the book written by Moses during the time of the Exodus. Jesus Christ could not sin. He called his 12 disciples early on in his ministry, symbolically regathering the 12 tribes of Israel. People would have seen what he was doing. They would have understood the picture. In Mark, he predicts the destruction of the temple. If you remember that story where he's walking past the temple, they're coming out from worship, and the disciples are going, hey, like, look how beautiful this structure is. It's so wonderful. And Jesus says, the entire thing will be destroyed. Not one stone left on another. He's not just predicting that the building would be destroyed, which it would in 70 AD by the Romans. He's telling them not only that, he's like, this entire system is done. The sacrifices are over. The need for the temple is over. The central place of worship, it's over. It's through because it's all in and through me now. When he turns the water into wine, his very first miracle. Remember that he's at a wedding feast and there's these massive jars of water and they run out of wine from the multi-day wedding feast. So his mother says, hey, Jesus, do something about it. And he gets a little frustrated. It's a funny story. But he takes these huge vats of water and turns them into wine. What was that water for? Rites of purification. People had to use that water to purify themselves before they could enter in to a religious ceremony. What's Jesus saying? You don't need that anymore. That wine is my blood. My blood purifies you for all time. It's a picture of who he would become. Everything he did is telling Israel, everything is about to change. Everything is being made new in me. And so on this final night of his life, he sits down to the Passover and says, this bread is now my body and this wine is now my blood. He's saying, just like you were freed from bondage in Egypt, you're being freed from your sin by me tonight in my death and resurrection. It was all meant to be a picture. Jesus, through his ministry, this is what Mark Clark says this. He says, the long-awaited new Exodus, spoken of by the Jewish prophets, whereby the whole world was being offered freedom, not from slavery in Egypt, but from Satan and sin and death, was now happening in and through him, Jesus Christ. Everything is changing. Now, getting towards the end here, the central theme of what Jesus Christ came and taught was this. The kingdom of God is at hand. Throughout Jesus' teaching, over and over and over again, what he talks about, what he preaches, what he promises, is the kingdom of God. Two verses that refer to it out of many, many. Mark 14, verse 25, it says, truly I say to you, I will not drink again of the fruit of the vine until that day when I drink it new in the kingdom of God. Matthew 4, verse 17, from that time Jesus began to preach, saying, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Kingdom of heaven and kingdom of God are used interchangeably by the gospel writer. This was what was central to his message. It's so critical for us to understand as his followers, if you call yourself a Christian, what is God's kingdom? It's not meant to be this idea of this earthly place in a walled city that sits somewhere that we're trying to enter. The kingdom of God is synonymous with the reign of God. So God's reign over his people is his kingdom. Our job as his followers is to expand his kingdom by bringing others in. By spreading the word, by telling the truth, by bringing people into the love and knowledge of Jesus Christ. And by that, the kingdom of God grows and expands. Too often, for far too long, we've assumed as the church that our responsibility, that our role is to get saved and get out of here. Put my faith in Jesus so I can go to the right place when I die, so I can escape all this muck here on earth, and I won't have anything to do with it. And we just do our best to avoid it the rest of the time we have here. It's not what you're called to. It's not what you're saved to. We are saved to be ministers of the kingdom of God. We are responsible to expand his kingdom. That's the mission. That's the job. That's why you're still alive. If the whole purpose of your salvation was for you to go to heaven when you die, God would kill you when you got saved. You're done. Okay. Moving on up. No. You are here for a purpose. We are here for a reason. God has saved you to continue his work of expanding his kingdom. In Jesus' day, there were several different sects of Jerusalem, of the Jewish faith. Each had kind of grown up in a different response to society around them and chose to live out their beliefs in a different way. And I think there's some pretty strong parallels to the way Christianity has divided itself today. I want to look at those just for a second as we get ready to close. Four different sects were this. First, there were the Sadducees, the Essenes, the Pharisees, and the Zealots. These are the four primary groups that the Jews had divided themselves into. The Sadducees, they believed they could bring in God's kingdom through political power. They cozied up to the Roman Empire and did everything they could to align themselves with that power, to have influence in the world. And they were fundamentally corrupted by it. They controlled the Sanhedrin. They were the ones primarily who lobbied for Jesus' crucifixion. Political power is no friend of faith. Cozying up to political power is not a path of righteousness for the Christian. We are not called to political power. We are called to be meek. Matthew 5, verse 5 says, "Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth." Not the politician, not the kings, not the rulers. The meek will inherit the earth. The Essenes. The Essenes were a sect of Judaism that removed themselves from society, that cloistered themselves off and closed off communities. We actually have them in large part to thank for the Dead Sea Scrolls. But they removed themselves and the sinful world around them, isolating themselves from the outside world to maintain purity. Some of us as followers of Jesus just want to keep our circle tight. Keep me away from the sinners of the world. Keep me away from the problems of the world and surround yourselves with Christians and church and never veer outside of that bubble to try and maintain purity. This is not what we are called to. Matthew 5 verse 14 says, "You are the light of the world. A city on a hill cannot be hidden." We are in this world to be in this world. You are not of this world, but you are in this world for a purpose so that we may go and reach and care for and love those that don't yet know Jesus. The Pharisees emphasized strict adherence to a set of rules going well beyond what God had commanded, confident that they could make themselves righteous, confident that by living perfectly and impeccably, that they, by their own strength, by their own bootstraps, could hoist themselves up to be good. We know that the scriptures tell us we are not good on our own. We cannot achieve righteousness on our own. Matthew 23, verse 27 says this, Jesus talking to the Pharisees. "Woe to you, Pharisees, you hypocrites. You are like whitewashed tombs which outwardly appear beautiful, but within are full of dead people's bones and uncleanness." If you think that by adhering to some set of rules, some set of laws, that you can make yourself righteous in God's eyes, you cannot. It is by the grace of Jesus Christ and his blood that we are made clean, not by your own acts. Then finally, there were the Zealots, who sought to overthrow their oppressors, to speak evil of and act violently towards those they disagreed with, committed to the violent overthrow of the Roman Empire, anyone who they viewed stood in their way. There are some Christians today who want to fight for our rights and our power as Christians, to dominate society, to make our nation a Christian nation, or anything like that. It's not what we're called to. It's not what we're called to care about. To vilify those we disagree with, it's not the way of Christ. Matthew 5, 44, "But I say to you, love your enemies. Pray for those who persecute you." These are the things that we are called to. Jesus tells us in all of Scripture that he's completed the old covenant, that he's the promised Messiah, that he's the Son of God, that he died for our sins. He calls his followers, he calls us, those who would call themselves Christians, to seek first the kingdom of God and its righteousness, to bring this kingdom to earth as it is in heaven. The question that remains for each of us to determine, who will he be to you? Be liar, lunatic, or Lord? Let's pray. God, thank you that there is evidence that we can look to, that we can see the reality of the existence of your Son. God, but that reality doesn't equal faith. God, as we look at facts, as we look at evidence, God, help us to have faith. Help let there be a bridge towards faith, God, that we may put our trust in you for our salvation, for our lives, God. We love you. In your name. Amen.
Well, good morning. We are so happy to have you here with us on taking a day on your long weekend, and I hope it's been a good weekend, though it's a little chilly out there this morning. It doesn't seem like a summer day, but we'll hope that it improves. I just have a few announcements for the week. Just to remind you that our office will be closed on Monday for the holiday. And our hours for the summer are going to be 9 to 1. So if you need anything, we're here between 9 and 1 in the office. And then we have the mom and baby group that's going to be starting at Waterworks Park on July 2nd. And it runs from 9:30 to 11:30 a.m. So please bring your little ones and gather with some other moms or and just enjoy that time together. The new sermon series starts today, and it is The Problem of Jesus. You can follow along with the book by Mark Clark, and it's available on Amazon, or if you prefer, you can listen to it on Audible. And July 7th, we are so excited to welcome Wesley Huff here as our special guest speaker. We are going to be posting on Instagram and Facebook some highlights about who Wesley is, and it will have a link to his website. So we really encourage you to check that out. And now I think that's everything for our announcements. I just ask that you bow your heads in prayer. So Father God, we gather here today under your care and protection. Lord, we thank you for your kindness that's everlasting. Lord, we just pray for our new sermon series that Jeremy's going to bring to us, to begin to bring to us today, Lord. And we just pray, Lord, that you would guide our thoughts, open our minds and hearts to this new series, Lord. And Lord, please keep us in peace as we go into the next week. Amen.
King is resurrecting me by your spirit. ashes of defeat. The resurrected King is resurrecting me. In your name I come alive.